church on fire. This is the Holy Spirit flame. We have a burning desire to make of Jesus' name.
Welcome to this service at Faith and Victory Church. This is the place to come to receive your miracle from God. Now, let's join our service already in progress.
We have a prayer cloth this morning, so we're going to pray over that. Amen. So if you'll just stretch your hands out with us, get in faith. Amen. Release your faith. Hallelujah, Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you. That is the word of God decreed that you wrought special miracles by the hands of Paul, inasmuch as aprons and handkerchiefs were taken from him and laid on people, and the sick were healed, and the demon spirits went out of them. We lay hands on this cloth now, thinking that the anointing of God is transferable. Thank you that the power of God goes into this material. And then when it's laid on the infirm, we thank you, Father God, that anointing is released and drives out from the top of their head to the soles of their feet. All that afflicts and causes discomfort in them, we thank you that they are the healed of the Lord from the top of their head to the soles of their feet. We thank you that any demon spirits in operation are driven out and removed from them. We decree that they are made every whit whole in the mighty and majestic name of Jesus. And thank you for the work of the anointing in their life. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. praise God. Go ahead and open your Bibles, if you will. I know you're thinking, where? Just go open them. You know, we'll find some place. Go ahead and open it, Acts 19. Hallelujah. I've been thinking about our ministry as of late. And, you know, we don't always see, as a matter of fact, we see more miracles taking place outside of our church in association with our ministry than we do here in the building. Just in the past year, we've had Joe had a friend at work that he wasn't working anymore. They had sent him home to die. Hospice had been called in and gave him 8 days to live. And he got a prayer cloth and took it to him. And just a couple months ago, he was back at work completely cancer-free and whole. Stage 4 cancer, told he's going to die. And then earlier this year, Janice took a prayer cloth to a lady with stage 2 breast cancer. She had the prayer cloth, went to the doctor on her next visit. Cancer was completely gone. They don't know what happened. We know what happened, but they don't know what happened. You know, the doctors just go, we don't know what happened. Well, we do. Praise the Lord. Can you say amen? And we have these things happen all the time. Just over the years of our ministry, I was thinking about back when I was an assistant pastor at Faith and Victory in Greenville. When we were down there, Pastor Zabowski was out of town, and I was preaching for him. And we had these two ladies who come from Rocky Mount, which is about 45 miles away. They come pretty regular to visit with us, and they came in and they had a prayer cloth because they had somebody they knew with tuberculosis. Well, you know, I didn't see them for a while because they didn't come all the time. You know, they would come and visit our church from Rocky Mount. And so a few months later, they came back, and I hunted them down and said, "Hey, whoa, what happened to the person with tuberculosis? Oh, they're healed." Praise the Lord. These are things that have happened. You know, David Ankrum's nephew, a number of years ago, had some weird disease that Duke diagnosed, but Duke Medical Center. It's a gene kicks, and they start growing backwards. In other words, their body starts shrinking. Did you hold up a Duke sign in my church? Come out, thou unclean. Oh, anyway, Larry held up a Duke sign right in the back. What are you doing with one of those in the church in the first place? I bind you in Jesus. All right, anyway. But 2 weeks after he got that prayer cloth, he started growing back normal and has been and normal ever since. I talked to Gwen. Well, I said, "How's he doing? He's normal, whole, healthy." So we believe that there's power according to the Word of God. It's the anointing. See, God, there. Did you know the Bible? I know I'm varying from where I'm going, but just kind of hang with me. There are gifts of healings. Now, if you go study back in the healing revival, do y'all mind if I go this way this morning? If we get back to here, we'll go back there, all right? All right. But there, you know, if you go back and study the different ministries in the healing revival, different ministers had different anointings. Now, William Branham was one. And that, now, they, Brother Hagin said that he could line up 10 deaf and mute people, and 9 out of 10 would be instantly healed. He had other ministries that, you know, if it was a blindness, they could lay hands on them. Every one of them were healed instantly, almost 9 out of 10 every time. Dad Hagin, he had the greatest success along growths, cancerous growths and things. His ministry had the greatest propensity. Why? Because there's gifts of healings. You know, you may be anointed in one place, you may not be anointed in another. You might be anointed where people that are deaf and mute get healed instantly, where a blind person gets healed in somebody else's ministry. Now, we can all pray in faith and agree, but there are special anointings, special manifestations of the Spirit. Amen. And I've come to understand that one of ours, just by experience, the Lord didn't say it. I didn't have a vision. You know, like, it'd be kind of cool to have the eight visions like Dad Hagen had. But then again, you know, some people can handle that stuff and some can't. Yeah. Amen. Some people get lifted up in pride. You know, they get told one thing, and man, they're a prophet, got prophet cards printed up and everything. You know, I'm prophet so and so. How old are you? 22? You ain't been, the only thing you're doing is profiting. You're not a prophet yet, you know. You're just what I'm handing out your business. I'm a prophet. Save it for Oprah. Anyway. But we just by experience, we've come to find out over the years that there's a strong anointing in the arena of prayer calls with us. Well, praise the Lord. Then, you know what? I can't. It'd be cool to look over every stretch and go, rise in the name of Jesus, and they all get up and walk off. But that doesn't always happen because, you know, listen, again, I always said this. We can always teach people the word and pray with them in faith and get people well. Amen. But you don't always have those special anointings working in everybody's ministry the exact same. So you can't copy somebody else's anointing. We can all exercise faith.
Yes.
Does that make sense? There's a difference. There, you know, we can all get an agreement and get people in the faith, and by their faith they can receive. But not everybody has the same anointing. So you're not always going to have the same manifestation. I've seen people who could throw water on people and get everybody well. I've seen other people try to copy it, and all everybody got was wet. Yeah. You know, I went to such church, and they threw water on everybody, and everybody in the room got healed, got saved, got filled with the Holy Ghost, speaking in tongues, and I'm going to go try and take the bucket of water and throw it on this congregation, and they're all madder than a wet sitting hen because they're wet. They didn't get anything.
Amen.
Well, when you learn how God uses you, you just flow with that and God blesses it.
Yeah.
Can somebody say amen?
Amen?
And then see, then we can stay where we know. And like Dad Hagen used to say, well, what happens if there's no anointing in manifestation? We give them the word.
Yeah.
We teach them what the word says. Amen. We put the word in them, praise God.
Right.
Amen?
Right.
And then if there's a manifestation of the Spirit, then we hook up with that. Otherwise, we give them the word.
Amen.
And we don't try to make something happen that's not there. Oh, somebody say hallelujah. Now that kind of brought me back to our series, The Prevailing Word. Let's look at Acts chapter 19. That's not one of them weird, freaky demon ringtones, is it? You know, one of them twilight things or something. Anyway, it says here, now remember we read all this last week. Let's read verse 18. And many that believed came and confessed and showed their deeds, and many of them also which used curious arts. Now you want a translation of that, King Jimmy? Demon stuff. Ouija boards. Don't buy your kids a Ouija board and think it's cool.
Amen.
They just had some place, it was on the news that these people were talking about, they were demon possessed doing stuff because they'd been playing with a Ouija board that night. I mean, it made national news. Confess up. How many had a Ouija board when you were a kid? Our family had one. My Pentecostal mama. Yeah, Pentecostal holiness. We had a Ouija board. Yeah, I know. But they didn't wear no lipstick. Anyway. Hallelujah. You know, they had the beehive hair doing no makeup on. Hallelujah. We had a Ouija board in the house. I remember one time they messed around with that thing and some things started happening. I thought, that's enough for me. That's weird.
Yeah.
Stuff started talking to you. You say, that's not true. I'm telling you, stuff started talking. You open the door for the devil, he'll run in. But for curious arts, so they bought their curious arts and books together and burned them before all men. They counted the price of them. They found it 50,000 pieces of silver. Verse 20. So mightily grew the word of God and prevailed. Now, I have in the past even done this. We like to take that scripture out and pull it out and say, the word of God grows and prevails. But you notice there was something that took place before it grew and prevailed. There was a commitment and a dedication of the heart to the things of God. If you're going to grow in the Word of God, you're going to have to sell out to the Word of God.
Amen.
That was a kind of a semi-enthusiastic amen. But this is a Word of Faith church, so if you're going to have the Word of God work in your life, you're going to have to sell out to the Word of God.
Amen.
That's much better. All right. We got to give it first place in our lives. So last week we talked about that the Word of God, Jesus being the personification of the Word, that Jesus' life, Jesus' ministry is a synopsis very small though, of the intent and design and plan and will of God in his word. In other words, when you want to kind of know an overview of the word of God, look at Jesus. Amen. Just, you know, did you see anybody that Jesus made sick? I can't. I challenge somebody. I'd give $1 million. Go find it. They can't find it. You see anybody where Jesus, you know, wouldn't heal them? Well, there's somebody came to him and he told them he wouldn't do it, but she got healed anyway because she got faith. It's not meet to take the children's bread and give it to the dogs. Remember? My door of life, the home grievously vexed of the devil. He said, it's not meet to take the children's bread and give it to the dogs. What healing was the children's bread.
Amen.
And she said, yeah, Lord, but the children eat the, I mean, the dogs eat the crumbs from the master's table. He said, great is your faith, be it unto you as you will. And her daughter was set free that very hour. Amen. Glory to God.
Amen.
So even in that one case, she still got it. Why? Because she was not in, she didn't have a covenant right to it, but she jumped in there by faith and got a hold of it. Praise God. Hallelujah. So, you know, you don't see Jesus making people poor. When he told the rich man that came to him to go sell all that he had, give to the poor, take up his cross and come follow him. Yeah, he was going to teach him how to get rich God's way and not man's way.
Amen.
See, the one problem with people who got rich carnally is that for them to learn how to get rich spiritually and by faith, and they want to try to use their practices in the carnal realm, cheating, stealing, lying, deceiving. And he said, give it all away, and I'll teach you how to get rich, but you'll get rich by faith.
Amen.
Now, here's the thing. When you get rich by faith, you don't have to look over your shoulders all the time.
That's right.
You get rich by ripping people off, and you are always looking over your shoulder because somebody coming to get you.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. So Jesus is the personification of the word. Then we talked about our attitude toward the word, that we need to reverence the word, that the word of God is a necessity, not a luxury.
Amen.
Oh, yeah. Thank you, Lord, for your day. Oh, the little daily bread thing in the middle of the table. Now, you better hope you got more than that when the devil shows up with cancer.
Amen.
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 Well, what was the scripture this day? Judas went out and hung himself. All right, you better get another one. Go and do thou likewise. Better get another one. What thou doest, do quickly. You better quit and get the whole Bible and start reading. Amen. Are you here? We can't live that way. You can't live that way. You got to know the Word of God is a necessity, not a luxury. Now, how many of you know that water is a necessity in your body? You can't go without water. You can go without food longer than you can go without water. It's not a luxury. It's a necessity. You got to have it. You got to have the Word of God. And you can't take preacher so-and-so's word for it. Not even mine.
Amen.
And the best thing is his peanut butter and sliced bread in your life. But no, I'm just joking. Come on. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Now, you've got to have the Word of God. And then we talked about how the Word of God and the Holy Ghost work together. Now, growing up Pentecostal holiness, then coming over among the charismatics and the Word of Faith people, there's an element in the fringe spirit side that we just need a goosebump and we got it. Whoa! Ha! Oh. Hello? Then you got the other side. I've got the Word of God. You're stiffer than a 2x4, dry kilned. There ain't no life in you. No, the Spirit and the Word work together. If it is the Holy Ghost, the letter killeth, but the Spirit gives life. If it's the Word of God being preached under the anointing, it's going to produce life. If it is the Spirit of God in manifestation, it's going to be in agreement with the Word of God.
Amen.
Well, I don't know what the Bible said, but the Lord told me to do this. No, he didn't.
Amen. Come on now.
I got to tell my pizza dream story. Those of you that have heard it before, just bear with me, while those who've never heard it before get to hear it. I was in the office one day, and I got a phone call from this girl. Can I speak to the pastor? Well, you got him. I got a question for you. Okay. I had a dream. Yeah? God showed me this man in the church and said, I'm going to marry him. Oh, really? Yeah. What does he think about it? He don't know it yet. Have y'all ever talked? Nope. Been out on a date? Nope. Well, how do you know? Now, we went on around this kind of conversation about 10 minutes, and finally, she let the cat out of the bag. Yeah, that cat. She went, well, and I kept questioning and prodding because I knew something wasn't right. And finally, she goes, well, he's married. Now, I didn't have time to filter this one. Y'all know what I'm saying? I didn't have time to come back and be, you know, real dignified, pastoral, and, you know, well, you know, maybe, you know. I said, you ate too much pizza last night. You had indigestion. That's why you dream what you dream. God didn't show you that. God said that you look on somebody else's spouse and lust after them. It's adultery. And you're telling me God gave you a dream, you're going to marry somebody else's husband? They married? Now, before we got there, I'd ask her, why haven't you talked to your pastor? Well, I can't talk to him about this. Then when she let the cat out of the bag, I knew why she couldn't talk to him about that. She thought she was going to dial a prophet and get somebody to give her a word that she could go act on that would allow her to pursue her flesh and not the word. And then blame it on the Holy Ghost. Listen, people call the church. And they want an answer. They want you to give them an answer that's contrary to what the word says. So they can go out and say, well, Pastor Taylor told me by the Spirit. If it's the Spirit, it's going to line up with the Word. I said, it's going to line up with the Word if it's the Holy Ghost. You're not going to have to, you know, you're not going to be able to go out here and say, well, the Lord showed me I could have 20 wives, just not married to but 19, but one of them, because the 19 had to be illegal because the state don't recognize it. They had that happen up in Virginia a few years ago. Yep, in Virginia. Oh, well, okay. Glad you got that straight. Just was wondering what kind of group you were hanging with. There's this pastor up in Virginia, just over in Danville, right across the state line there. He was 40-something. His wife was 40-something, but she looked like she'd been rode hard and put up wet one time too many. Y'all get that? I mean, she just won't carry it. She won't carry the youthful image that he was in the gym lifting weights, getting buff and all this kind of stuff. And the Lord had showed him that it was all right to have another wife. Now, he picked out a 16-year-old chick in the church. And the parents had become convinced by him as the pastor that it was all right for him to marry her before God. Couldn't get married according to the law because it was illegal. And he wasn't going to divorce because that was against God's law. And he was in this church going to marry this 16-year-old girl before God. The God's name was Beelzebub, Lord of the flies. He's violating the word of God, and he knew it, but he convinced everybody. See, you got to stay with the word.
Amen.
Amen. And when you say the Holy Ghost is involved, he's going to line up with the word. So when people start prophesying stuff and saying things, you know, and yea, thus saith the Lord, you still, did you know you're still a judge of that? We got people running around with some kind of messed up concept about not judging anything, just walking in love, being dumb. That's like sticking your head in the ground like an ostrich and saying, drop kick me, Satan, through the goalpost of life. Amen. You have to judge things according to the word. And somebody starts giving a word that doesn't line up with the word, it ain't a word.
Yeah.
And it'll get you in trouble. I've seen people get married that way. Now, one of the things that I refused to do was give Jerry a word. Thought, dear Lord, is he ever going to hear from heaven? You don't mind if I use that, do you? Do you mind if I use this? You do mind? I'm going to use it anyway because Janice told me I could. She's the boss. See, Janice knew Jerry was supposed to marry her. I knew Jerry was supposed to marry Janice. But Jerry didn't know Jerry was supposed to marry Janice. Now, actually, I think he probably did. He was just a little whatever timid about moving in that direction. That's just a guess. But here's the thing. When Jerry decided that was the right thing to do, that was his decision between him and God. And the devil can't come back to him and say, you know, when they're in a rough place, if you have a rough place, Pastor put this on you.
Amen.
Pastor gave you that word. You're married because pastor says you weren't supposed to marry that woman. See? No, he got it from heaven himself. He got the right thing from his own heart. Now he can stand, and he don't have to. The devil can't use the pastor gave that to you. Pastor's connected you. Pastor's playing Cupid. Got you two hooked up. Now there's trouble in the house, and you're gonna blame the. Now I can get out of this because I wasn't supposed to be married to her in the first place. No, he's heard from heaven. When we came to Greensboro, it was so supernatural how we came to Greensboro. There's been opportunity to leave. I can't leave because of the event that God supernaturally spoke to me. Nobody prophesied it to me. Now, people told me afterwards, yeah, that's what you're supposed to do. Well, I said, you know, I've known the Lord supernaturally. I mean, supernaturally. I don't have time to go into this, but it was supernatural. Go to Greensboro. Well, I ain't had that supernatural event tell me to leave. If he can get to me and tell me to go, he can get to me and tell me to leave if I'm supposed to leave.
Amen.
Now, and everybody knows when you get into a tough place, your flesh wants to pack up and move on.
Right.
Anybody ever had your flesh want to pack up and move on?
Amen.
Amen. Now, I'm going to tell you something. I'm going to do a little meddling right now. Some of you folks need to stop messing around and get busy about walking out your commitments before the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Glory to God. Where you are right now is where you need to be. I don't like the way he looks no more. He went and got Dunlap's disease. What's that? His chest done lapped over his belt. Chest and drawer disease. Your chest done dropped into your drawers. You know what I mean? He used to be like Schwarzenegger. I mean, walk around all buff, you know, get in front of the mirror and I can't even suck it in, have to do it anymore. Some people have six packs. I got a 2-liter. Anyway. Hallelujah. Now, the Word of God and the Holy Ghost are going to be in agreement with each other. They're not going to give you something that are different. So watch out for people who give you things that the Spirit saying, or you're thinking the Spirit saying something, and then you can't go bear it out with the written Word.
Right.
You know, Dad Hagin told the story a number of years ago about the oil guy. He was drilling for oil and wasn't getting anything. The Lord spoke to him in prayer and said, go drill your oil well. Told him exactly where the geological was to go drill it. He said, now drill at a 45 degree angle. He goes out to his foreman and says, hey, come over here. You see this? Boom. I want you to drill right here, and I want you to drill the well at a 45 degree angle. He said, there's nothing there. We've already done the geologicals. He said, go drill. And the guy argued with him. He finally said, look, I pay you to do what I tell you to do. Drill here. Drill the well at a 45 degree angle. It struck oil. Well, that guy wasn't convinced. Sometimes miracles don't impress people. Comes back out and says, the Lord showed me we're supposed to drill over here and drill another well and drill it at 45. Now, there's the geologicals. We've already done it. There's nothing there. He went and did it. Got oil. After about the third time, the guy came and said, threw all the geologicals away and said, where do you want to drill next? Because they're striking oil every time. Why? The Spirit of God. Now, he gave his testimony in a meeting, and there was another oil guy in there. He said, I'm going to try that. Well, here's the problem. He didn't have the word of the Lord on that. Now, you cannot use God is no respecter of persons as a catch-all to copy everything everybody else does.
Amen.
What is it that God is not a respecter of persons in? God is not a respecter of persons in prospering the other guy.
Yes.
But how he prospers him does not fit into that category. This guy went out and tried to start drilling oil wells at 45-degree angles and went bankrupt. Why? Because the Lord didn't tell him to do it that way. Now, the Lord still wanted to prosper him, but he just gave this other guy specific ways to do it. He'll give you specific ways to do it. He might tell Cap, go do this, and you can't copy that because you don't have faith for it, because you don't have the word for it. Maybe allowing the word of God in the reign of prosperity, but doing the how is not the same. Thank you. It's just like when these guys show up multi-level marketing, they show up at your house, and if you're working for somebody else, you're in a rut. Do you know God can prosper you when you work for somebody else? I told one guy one time, he came in and said, you know, he's going to turn our church into a huge church. I said, the first time I catch you with one of my church members off in the corner telling them that they're employed by somebody else, that they're in a rut and the rut's just a grave with both ends kicked out, I'm going to pick you up by the seat of the pants and throw you out the front door of the church. Do you understand me? Didn't come back much. Say, Pastor, that's kind of harsh. Yep. But I'm not going to have people messing with people when they can get prospered by working for somebody, by working for yourself, however God leads you to go and be employed or whatever, God can prosper you in any of those arenas. Because the job is not your source. It's just a place where God's getting it out to you. He's the source. If we said everybody in this business part had to plug in this one receptacle over here, we blow the amp. We blow the circuit. Because we, you know, that's, can't anybody plug into that one? Now we can plug into it and get stuff off of it. They can plug in where God tells them to plug into, and they can get stuff off of it. We can't all do the same place. And so what God tells us to do, still going to be in line with the Word of God. So the Holy Ghost and the written Word always agree. And here's where we find out. The Word of God said, if we bring the tithe and offering into the storehouse, He'll bless us. He'll open the windows of heaven. He'll prosper us. You know, Jesus said, give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, men will give into your bosom. What can we all do that is the same? We can give and we can tithe. But that's what the Word tells us to do. If something else outside of that that's specific that God speaks to you, it still has to be in line with the Word. Do this and I'm going to prosper you. Didn't say if he told Jerry do this and I prosper you that Jeff can copy it.
Amen.
Because it's not a word to Jeff.
Amen.
Now, what Jeff can jump in on is the Word of God says if I'll tithe and give, then Lord, you know, you give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, multiply my seed sown. I thank you, you give me seed to sow. What, you know, you give me employment, you give me a place to work, you give me, you know, whether it's self-employed, work for somebody else, whatever it is, I'm getting seed to sow and bread to eat. And you are multiplying my seed sown.
Amen.
Amen. All right. So now let's move on from there. Now that we're out of time. Who'll give me 5 more minutes? 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35, 40. Okay, I got 40 more minutes. All right, thank you. The Word of God is the instrument in our life that brings us into harmony with God's will. You cannot know that if you're in harmony with God's will unless you know what the Word of God says. Your good feelings don't do it. You can start singing good vibrations about a beach voice. That's not going to cut it with knowing the good will of God. You come into the harmony of the will of God by the Word of God. You know what His will is because of what the Word says. You do not know it because you got a good... Look, I grew up Pentecostal. We believed in goosebumps. Listen, I don't throw that out. I love the manifestation of the Spirit. I love to be in the presence of the Holy Ghost. I love getting goosebumps. But I've gotten them in the theater when they showed a horror scene from a horror movie. So I can't be led by goosebumps. I got to be led by the Word. I got to have the Word of God so I can know the will of God. Amen? Now, first of all, we're born of the Word. We're born again of the Word. Without the Word of God, you cannot be born again. You didn't get saved because you shook the preacher's hand, because you got water baptized, took first communion, got dunked, sprinkled, or anything else. You got born again by confession of the Lordship of Jesus Christ and the belief in your heart that God raised Him from the dead. How do you know? Because Romans chapter 10, verses 8, 9, and 10 tells us so. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 23 says, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, the Word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. The Word of God is the agent which brings you into the kingdom of God. You're born of the Word. It produces life in you. It produces God's life in you. Can you say amen? You don't have to confess. You don't have to do this. You don't have to do that. You just come into the church and join our connect group and you're going to heaven. No, you're not. You can connect with a bunch of people who think they're connected and all of them go to hell. Thank you for your enthusiasm. We don't want to make anybody feel uncomfortable. Why? You should be uncomfortable living outside the plan of God. You should not be comfortable living in sin. You should not be comfortable not born again. You should not be comfortable not having the life of God in you. And when you come in contact with the things of God, it should make you uncomfortable. My God, we try to make it so palatable that we wash it down so far that nobody, if they just see how wonderful it is, they'll want to be in. Behold the goodness and the severity of God. Now see, I used to kind of take the position that, man, nobody will, it's all hunky-dory, just tell them how good God is, everybody's going to want to get saved. I've seen people not want to get saved because of all that.
Amen.
Jesus preached about hell. Did y'all know that Jesus preached about hell? The Lord Jesus Christ, the head of the church, preached about hell. And he preached about it a lot. Now, that don't mean we get in here every week and say, you're going to hell, you bunch of sinners. But the truth of the matter is, people need to be confronted with who they are, where they are, and the answer to what that is. If you're lost without God, without hope, here's the answer. Instead of kind of going, you're okay, I'm okay, let's sing the Barney song. I love you, you love me, we're a happy family, with a great big hug and a kiss from me to you. Won't you say you love me too? What do you think, baby bop? And we're all going, oh. Jesus said, go into all the villages and say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. He didn't sing some. No, no, no. If you put Duke up there, you're fired. He's had Barney queued up for 6 weeks. I hadn't sang the Barney song in a long time. We get this hippie idea. Some of you are old hippies. I had hair down to my shoulders. When it was wet, it was halfway down my back. My nickname was Bush. Not after George or George H. W. Because of my hair. Now, it wasn't quite a fro, but it was on its way. Because I was real bushy hair. Long, it was long, you know. I mean, I put my football helmet on, it was hanging all out, you know, and all that kind of stuff. I remember my sophomore year, baseball coach said you had to cut your hair. I cut it from here to here. That was a mess with you. Bush Taylor. Yeah, I was a hippie. You know, we were kind of all hippies, you know. And back then, how many remember? We liked to sing the Coca-Cola song. I want to teach the world to sing in perfect harmony. It's the real thing. And we all talk about love and peace. And we got these mindsets about things that are unscriptural. Think we just have love and harmony. So you can't have real love and real harmony until you know the author of love on an intimate basis, and his love is shed abroad in your heart by the Holy Ghost. Amen. That's when you can know the love of God. Amen. The other stuff is just fleshly love. And it'll turn on you like a cornered snake. You ever seen a boy and a girl break up? I mean, the day before it was so sappy and syrupy about how they loved each other. I mean, I knew one person, they would say, I love you. And the other person would say, thank you. This isn't some chipmunk cartoon. Thank you. Gag a maggot. I love you. Thank you. Well, you know, we just got to love people. Now, with love, the world of termination. I'm thinking about Terminator. Terminology. I tell you, see, y'all didn't know this. I have a doctorate in neology. I'm a neologian. He who makes up new words. There you go. But see, we get this idea that just, you know, if we kind of have this love meaning, what it really means in the world is you can't challenge me on what I believe. You have to accept anything I say or do. But the Bible doesn't do any of those things. The word has a standard. And people come, what the Lord showed me. No, if the Lord shows you, it's going to be what the word says. Your life is to emulate his. And the only way it can emulate his is to be born of him. And we're born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, the word of God. Amen. Hallelujah. The word seed in the Greek is sperma. It is the seed of God to our spirits. We're born of that. Jesus told Nicodemus, except the man be born again, or born anew, other translations say, he'll not see the kingdom of heaven. Nicodemus got messed up with that. He said, can a man enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born again? And of course, you know, you can think his mom was thinking, no way, Jose. We're not going through that again. No, born of the Spirit. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. We cannot have fleshly governance of our life. We are the circumcision, which worship God in the Spirit and have no confidence in the flesh. Oh, and rejoice in Christ Jesus and have no confidence in the what? The flesh. We're born of the word. Hallelujah. That's 5 of my 40 minutes. Y'all with me still? Anybody think about hot dogs yet? All right. Next one. This one, I'm going to finish on this next, because it's really only three. It's 5 to 12. I don't, as late as I thought it was. I looked at the clock wrong. So y'all gave me the 4 to 1 o'clock, right? There's no service tonight. We know, look at Romans chapter 12. So you're born again of the Word. Now, I have an entire series I taught on this years ago, and probably will teach it again, but it's just, we're going to have to do a real supernatural capsulization of it. Romans chapter 12. We'll start in verse 1. I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Now, the word reasonable is, can be better translated, spiritual. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove is that good and perfect, acceptable and perfect will of God. I preached a sermon a number of years ago called Breaking World Conformity. The word conformed here, kind of like, how many ever made Jell-O and put it in molds? Yeah. And dumped it out, and they had all kinds of shapes to it and that kind of stuff. How many have ever done that? What, does this generation not do anything cool anymore? I got a cell phone. Woo! I mean, how about, you know, some really cool shaped Jell-O pad things, you know, dump it out, and it's a pirate ship or something. Huh? We gave you the K&W, they're all square. Ay, ay, ay. For those of you who understand molds, you know, we used to take the Jell-O, we get it all mixed up and pour it into the mold and put it in the refrigerator, you know, upside down. Chill it, get it gelatin, get it turned to gel, turn it over and come out, and it'll be shaped to the mold. And the Word of God says, be not conformed. That word conform means to be molded or shaped or fashioned, just like you would a mold of Jell-O or something like that. Don't be molded, shaped, fashioned according to the world. See, God doesn't want you to be like the world. I know there's teaching out there right now that says you can be just like the world, it's okay. They call it seeker sensitive, seeker friendly, seeker this, seeker whatever. You know, I want to be Holy Ghost sensitive. I want to be Holy Ghost friendly. I want to be Holy Ghost imaged. Because He just told me not to be conformed to the world. Amen. I'm not to be shaped by the world. I'm not to be fashioned by the world. I'm not to be conformed to the world. Amen. I'm to have a different appearance, a different look. Study Jesus' ministry. Remember I said this, that He is the personification of the written word, the whole word. He is the Logos. He's the living word. Right. He wore His rabbinical clothing. They referred to Him as teacher, rabbi. Yes, He ate with publicans and sinners. He ate with them to share the life of God with them. But He wasn't dressed like them. Right. He was dressed like a priest. He was dressed like a teacher, a rabbi, a rabboni. He wore the purple sash that was so expensive the Roman soldiers didn't want to tear it apart. They cast lots to get it because it was so expensive. He didn't strip down and look like a street beggar to win the people to the Lord. Amen. See, we got this idea, we got to look like the world, act like the world, think like the world, and talk like the world to win the world. Amen. They already got that.
Amen. Amen.
They don't need any more of that. They need life, and life more abundantly. And my life is to represent Him, and I'm to be like Jesus. That don't mean you can't wear a Hawaiian shirt to preach it. I'm not talking about that. Lord, you got the memo this morning. Dress down day. Yeah, no tie. Lord always has a tie on. Going to the picnic. Okay. We're to be different than the world. See, we got this idea that the world thinks it's cool that we're cool. They might tell you that. But when they're laying in bed at night and they're hurting because their girlfriend broke up with them, their husband left them, their kids just got found, they got cancer, they got some kind of disease. When they're all alone and they're hurting, and they go to their buddies and their buddies just sit down and drink with them, smoke dope with them, say, oh man, I don't know what to tell you, man, I'm far sorry for you. I'm going to tell you who people come looking for. They come for those that they've seen Jesus in, who act like Jesus, talk like Jesus, who walk like Jesus, who are not conformed to this world, who didn't take on the world's imagery or take on the world's look to be cool, but took on the nature and the character of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Now, I remember when I worked at, I worked at Parker's Barbecue down in Greenville after I got out of Raymond. I was a computer programmer, but trying to go do programming and get the church on week, you know, they work on weekends and nights and, you know, stuff at that level I would have been at. It just didn't work. So I went back to the restaurant, worked there. I worked 8 years in the bar. Aren't y'all glad I worked in that barbecue restaurant though? But I taught y'all what real barbecue tastes like around here. Yeah. And everybody, Brother Bill. Brother Bill brought down there in Lexington. He said, there's nothing better than Lexington until he tasted mine. Hallelujah. Instantly converted him. Hallelujah. He had an experience he had never had before. Anyway, I'd go into the restaurant, work, talk about the Lord, talk about Jesus. Now, they'd make fun of me. You know, can I just share that this era and that restaurant back in the late, mid-70s and early 80s, it was still the old school. They had white guys and black girls working in the kitchen because they thought they wouldn't fraternize if they did. I don't know where they got that from. White folks and black folks have been fraternizing for centuries. Why do they think all of a sudden they're going to put them in a kitchen to separate them and they ain't going to be dating? What's wrong with you? They was dating then. But anyway, just to set the cultural atmosphere, they would always call me brother. And usually had a twang, so it didn't mean, it wasn't respect for brother, it was brother. It was always kind of twanging on my walk with the Lord. Yeah. Except one day, one girl came in, she was real solemn. She said, it wasn't brother with aunt, it was brother. I found a lump this morning. I said, step out here. We just stepped out of the kitchen to a breezeway there. And I laid hands on her and prayed over in the name of Jesus, commanded the curse die and leave her body. I said, now go check yourself. She came back and it was gone. Praise the Lord. Then somebody else came in. They were. You understand, these are not sick pay jobs. If you ain't there, you don't get paid.
Yeah.
Girl came in sick. She's got a baby at home and all this kind of stuff. She's got support. And she said, I can't work. I feel so sick. I said, let me do this. Let me pray for you. Give me 15 minutes, and then let's see what happens. So I prayed for her. 15 minutes later, she came in, went to work. She said, I'm well. Now, after about 2 months of that kind of stuff going on, they start coming in. Brother, I got saved last night. They were all getting saved right and left. Amen. So you can't conform to the world and reach the world. As a matter of fact, the Word of God says, don't be conformed to the world. He went on and said this, but be ye transformed. Right, the word transformed comes from the Greek metamorpho. Now, I don't think you have to be a rocket scientist or a linguist to figure out where we get our word from. Metamorphosis. Caterpillar to a butterfly. Tadpole to a bullfrog. It's a metamorphosis. That entity becomes something completely different. Acts different, looks different, functions different. And the Word of God says, don't be fashion, shaped, molded according to this world, but experience the metamorphosis of being different, acting different, thinking different, existing differently. How? By the renewing of your mind. God's Word is the very thing that will challenge you and change you and make you something different as you feed on it, study it, look into it, and let it work in your life. When you look at the Word of God and it says do certain things, do them. Amen. You know, the Bible says this. I've had people say stupid stuff. A few years ago, I got into a conversation with somebody on Facebook. They said, I don't have to tithe. I don't have to give. I don't have to submit. I don't have to go to church. I don't have to do this, da, 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 because I'm under grace. I thought, the New Testament tells you to do every one of those things. I'm under grace. I don't have to do any of that. You don't have to submit? Nope. Submit to one another, Bible says. I don't have to obey. Obey those with the rule of you, New Testament. Tithe. Well, the Bible says in the book of Hebrews that Jesus receives our tithes. Yeah. Don't go to church. For an eight, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together as the manner of some. I just went on to list scripture after scripture after scripture. No, I'm under grace. Any of those things are works. Can I say this with kindness? You're stupid. That's kind. Yeah. Let me say it in French. To a idiot. Is that right, Shannon? To a bet. No, to me, that's stupid. To a fuck. That's messy, but cool. And fuck. You're an idiot. Whenever you can start getting outside the Word of God, and listen, why does anybody want to be like what they were when they got saved? Well, when I got saved, they used to run around with women and drink. Now that I'm saved under grace, I can run around with women and drink. No, you can't. You're not to be conformed to this world. You're to be transformed by the renewing of your mind so you think like, talk like, act like God. Be imitators of God as dear children. Not look like you used to look like. Not see how much you can get away with. I'll win people to the Lord. No, you won't. What wins them to the Lord is you showing how to live a life out of the Word of God, by the Spirit of God, representing Jesus Christ, being an imitator of Him in the earth, and people seeing God in action through you. Not that you're going to heaven and you act like just like you just act like you used to act like. A couple went to a pastor I know, went a couple counseling because they weren't getting along. They're not married. Couple counseling. Saw some movie in Hollywood, I guess. And after a few minutes, he said, "I figured out what your problem is." They said, "Oh, they're so excited." "Yeah, what is it?" "You're living together. You're not married. You're fornicating." "Oh, no, Pastor. We're under grace. That doesn't matter." He just looked at him. Said, "Well, I'll tell you what. If you really believe that, I can't help you. And you're probably in the wrong church." That's harsh. No, that's truth. If you won't do what the Word says, there's no hope to fix you. Now, see, I know, see, you came thinking, I was just going to tell you that you're the greatest thing since peanut butter and sliced bread. No, that's me. Now, it's a joke. You're supposed to laugh. It's trying to lighten the atmosphere just a little bit. You see, when we just tell people everything's wonderful and don't show the truth, we have to change. We have to grow. And we grow by doing the Word. Joshua 1:8 says the Word of God, or the Book of Law for the Arab, but it was the Word of God. So the Book of the Law or the Word of God shall not depart out of your mouth, but you'll meditate therein day and night. What? That you may observe to do according to all that is written therein. The purpose of meditating on the Word is not so you can talk about how cool it is. It's so you can do it and live it. And then Joshua says, "For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and thou shalt have good success." The good success and the prosperity does not come until you're meditating and doing. We got people teaching people they're going to prosper and do good whether they meditate and do it or not. As a matter of fact, they don't have to do it because they're under this new thing called grace. Well, grace isn't new. Biblical grace has been around all along. Looney Tune grace hasn't been. It's not really grace. That's really not grace. That is not grace that you... God would not empower you to stay the same.
Yeah.
And that's what people are saying. It doesn't matter if I smoke. It doesn't matter if I drink. It doesn't matter if I fornicate. It doesn't matter what I do. I'm still going to heaven. That is an empowerment to remain the same. God's empowered you to change. God's empowered you to have a transformation. God's empowered you through His Word to be different. How about this one? Be holy, for I am holy. Now, folks don't like that word. H-O-L-Y. It is a four-letter word. And to most Christians, it's a four-letter cuss word. But God said, "Be ye holy, for I am holy." Boy, get quiet. See, if you start talking about the blood of Jesus, well, what? I mean, you're going to have $1 million next week if you'll give to the pastor this morning. People be running in the church. You come up here and start saying, "Hey, you got to live right." Who do you think he is talking to me that way? Turn it to your neighbor. See, a minute ago it was the Holy Ghost, now it's me. Now it's the Holy Ghost all along. Thank you for your enthusiasm. I left my Bible. There's my Bible. Be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. Why? When you transform your mind and think like God thinks, and let the Word of God work in you, that you may prove what is that good, perfect, and acceptable will of God. It is the knowledge of the Word of God that empowers you to know His will. I've heard people pray, "I grew up this way." I'm telling you, Lord, heal them if it's your will. They hadn't read their Bible. I said they haven't read their Bible. Amen. How do you know? At least they haven't read Peter. 1 Peter 2:24, who his own self bore our sin in his own body on the tree, that we being dead to sin should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. Theologically, that's talking about the spiritual disease of sin. Hogwash! Because Isaiah chapter 53 says that by his stripes we are healed. And then Matthew chapter 8, verses 16 and 17 says that even they brought him all that were sick and the oppressed of devils. And he healed the sick and cast out the devils with his word, that it might be fulfilled with that which was spoken by the prophet Isaiah. Himself took our infirmities and bare our diseases. Yeah. They were physical. They weren't spiritual. I said they were physical. They weren't spiritual.
Amen.
See, when we know what the word says, we can know God's will. That's why it's so important to know what the word says. We can't run around all the time, you know, hoping so, maybe so, you know, well, so-and-so said, well, what if so-and-so's wrong?
Amen.
Now listen, how many grew up, now some of y'all grew up in church. How many ever heard this statement? The Lord helps those who helps themselves. How many ever heard that? Now I'm going to tell you something. When I got saved, I thought that was Bible. I had a strong score. Then the other one. Cleanliness is next to godliness. Ha! I mean, you can hoop on that one. Ha! You know, go for it. I got saved and somebody asked me where that was. And back then, see, we didn't have electronic Bibles back then. I had the big old Strongs. I looked for a week. I got desperate. And started looking at the V's. And the A's, because Strong's has a list of all of them. And finally gave up. I knew it was in there. How do you know that? Because Grandma said it was. The Lord helps those who help themselves, and cleanliness is next to godliness. I finally figured it out. It's in one of those books that got left out called the Book of First Opinions. Because neither one of them are in the Bible. No, God came to help those who couldn't help themselves. He came to clean us up who couldn't cleanse ourselves. Glory to God. Amen. But it takes a cooperation with him and knowing what his word says. That's why we're commanded to go in the word and preach the gospel to every creature. And he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. Why? They got to hear the word of God on salvation so that faith can come, so that they can believe. They're not going to believe with some hokey pokey garbage. Come to our church and join our connection group and you'll go to heaven. No, you won't. Give them a copy of Led Zeppelin's Stairway to Heaven so they can all think they're going to get out sometime. Now you better give them the Eagles Hotel California. You can check in, but you can never check out. See, even the Rockers couldn't get it right. One guy thought it was back passageway out. Another guy finally figured out you ain't getting out. We tell people all kinds of stuff. You're okay. It's all right to be like you are. God likes you. No, God loves you. He does not like your sin. He does not love your sin, but he loves you and sent Jesus to die for you and commands men everywhere to repent.
Yes.
Jesus commissioned the church to tell the world. I mean, he told us, like, go tell them, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Peter got up and said, repent. Every one of you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Over and over again, that word is used in the Bible. We're trying to be cute these days. We want to get big crowds and not have anybody challenge with who they are and where they are in eternity. I'm telling you, folks, we're standing in the seat of eternity. We're not standing at a football game. This isn't about whether the Panthers beat the Saints this year or not. This is about your eternal soul. And it is about the eternal soul of men and women in the earth. And we got to stop playing games and start preaching that Jesus Christ is the Lord of all and that all men must bow their knee and confess his lordship.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And get a church that's got some gumption and go out there and in the face of criticism say, ye must be born again.
Amen.
Instead of saying, climb our rock climbing wall. I don't care if you got a rock climbing wall as long as the folks climbing it are on the rock.
Yeah.
and you're not convincing that it's okay to be like they are. We got to stop playing games in the church. Men and women are going to hell. They're closing their eyes and they're drawing their last breath and they're going to eternity without the knowledge of Jesus Christ. And there's a church sitting around playing games of success and trying to be cute and trying to get large at the expense of the souls of men and women. So they can ride around in their fancy cars as the pastors and fly around their airplanes. I don't care about those things. It's all right if you got them. But you better not get up on the back of unsaved souls.
Amen.
And compromise the word of God so you won't lose followers or lose congregants. When you get to heaven, your hand tailored suits ain't gonna get you past anything. I know a lot of ministers that have airplanes that are great, wonderful ministries. Love God. Do great things for God. But it's not about your plane. We got ministries now that will not preach the truth because they'll lose financial support. You got to be like Jesus. Do you know Jesus lost his whole team but 12 people in one day? One sermon. One statement in the sermon. Except you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you have no part of me. And they all got up and walked out except the 12. And he looked at them and said, well, you going to go too? And he said, where do we go? You're the one that's got the words of life. But everybody else packed up and left. That takes courage. Or it takes commitment to the truth. We've got to be committed to the truth. We got to be committed to the Word of God. We got to be committed to the things of God so that we can present truth to humanity. And we can't be conformed to the world. We got to be transformed by the renewing of our mind so we can share reality with people. And the reality is, if you don't know Jesus, you're not going to heaven. And you can't have some Muslim Christian joint service and get away with it.
It's true.
Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. And if you say anything else, you're a false prophet and a liar.
Amen.
And I don't even attempt to modify that. Jesus is one of the prophets. No, Jesus said he's the way, the truth, the life. No man goes to the Father but by him. So either he is the truth or he's the biggest liar that ever was. You can't have him halfway. Him and Muhammad were buddies. No, they weren't. Because Muhammad said he was the way. Jesus said, I am the way. Not a way, the way. I am the truth. I am the life. And then he went on to speak, but so you just couldn't misinterpret it. No man comes to the Father but by me. There's no in between there. There's no gray. There's no ifs, ands, buts, or maybes. There's no shading it and kind of twisting the words and pulling a lawyer on it.
Right.
Well, he really meant this by the inflection. No, he made it real clear. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. The book of Acts says, there is no other name under heaven whereby men must be saved but at the name of Jesus. No other name. That pretty much means no other name. Last time I checked, no other name means no other name. Then mean you could use Leroy and get saved. He said the name of Jesus is the only name whereby men must be saved. We try to be cute. We don't want to take a stand anymore. If somebody tries to interview us or talk to us, we want to hedge a little bit so we don't offend anybody. We got to preach the truth, and if it offends them, it offends them. If the truth offends them, that's their problem, not mine. Yes, being harsh, you're not walking in love. Yes, I am, because if I don't give them the truth, there's no way for them to get saved if I don't give them the truth. The love of God compels me to give them the truth, even if they don't like it. We had a generation of people who tried Dr. Spock's parenting method. Look at what we got. You don't spank your children, you teach them to hit. No, I beat the daylights out of them when they were young. They did not like it when I went to the paint store when I wasn't buying paint. Because I was getting that 5-gallon stir. Two of them, tape them together. You spank your children? Yeah, I beat them. Beat, B-E-A-T. On the beaten spot. You're harsh. The Bible says the rod of correction drives rebellion from the heart of the child. And he who spares the rod hates his child. I obey God, not man. Spock didn't know what he was talking about. I ain't talking about the pointy ear guy. I'm talking about the one who wrote the book that everybody thought was the holy Bible of parenting. You don't spank your children. You never tell them no because you break their spirit. Are you kidding me? And some of you moms, I know some of you moms, you think, I say no. I tell them no before they even think about doing it. What did Steve Harvey say one time? He saw some woman beating her child in the mall. They did something, and he turned around and saw some grandmama, and she had the young and said, going, if you ever do what that child just did, I'll kill you. Child hadn't done anything. You see that? Bam! That's called preventive spankings, I guess. Now, the Bible has things to say about that. Church, it's time to wake up and get busy about the things of God. Humanity is facing things they've never faced before. Everybody thinks if we fix the political system of our country. Let me tell you something. Our political system is messed up. I don't care what side of the aisle you sit on, if you sit in the middle. It doesn't matter. It's messed up. And the church has gotten messed up. And it's time for the church to be the church. And start speaking what God says, whether it works to our political gain or our political persuasions or not. We got to say what the Bible says.
Amen.
If the Word says it, we do it.
Right.
And there's unity among the believers because we're acting on the Word, not trying to get some special favor for a bunch of people who don't give a rip about you.
Amen.
I don't care what party they are.
Amen.
They don't care about you. They're all in there getting set up for their retirement. One vice president left office with no money. He's now worth $200 million. $200 million. They all get out, Republican, Democrat, Independent, Socialist, I don't care what part of there. They all get out and got favors from all these companies they did favors for while they were in office. And they all rich. How many of you checked on your congressman to see how many are poor?
Yeah.
And we're all trying to be cute in the church. Let's get busy about the things of God. And let's get the church together. Let's let the church have a voice.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's right.
And the church rises up and say, we're not going to have homosexual marriage in this country.
Yeah.
Well, it's already been passed. We can change that.
Yeah.
It can be changed.
Yeah.
Come on now.
Yeah.
They got. I don't know if you know about the common. I'm not really rambling. I'm talking about the church doing the word. Common Core is falling apart all over the country. But I saw the fourth grade sex education book. It's disgusting. It's pornographic. It has comic characters and sexual positions and acts doing all kinds of stuff. From self-gratification to intercourse. Fourth grade. And this is what the people think your children need. No morality. Just how everything works. Fourth grade. I'm not talking high school. I'm talking fourth grade. Church needs to be the church and say, we're not going to have this junk in our country. We're so divided. We're so whatever. We can't, you know, we're doing stuff because this is going to favor me. This is going to favor me. I want this. No, we need to go with this favors the word. That's right. That's what God. We got to do with the word. Church has to be the church. I said the church has to be the church, and we got to be busy about doing the will of God and the work of God, and get folks saved. and then demanding of our leaders and the political parties, you do what the Bible says. And you stop playing Mickey Mouse games, and we're going to vote you back in out of office. Because we're going to find somebody that's going to do what the Bible says. We're going to find godly men and women. Amen. Amen. That went over big. See, you get on some things, people get quiet. Y'all shouted a minute ago. You're going to tell your kids they got to go listen to this mess? Just had a big Supreme Court ruling. They cannot stop steward-initiated prayer. Amen. It just back against God. They cannot stop it. So if your kids are in school and the principal sends them home and says, they prayed in school and I am not going to have that in my school, tough, Jack. The Supreme Court just said they can. You can't do anything about it. As a matter of fact, you just violated my child's rights. I'm bringing a lawsuit against you.
Amen.
Now take that. They're so scared of the ACLU coming in. They better be scared of the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ coming in.
Amen.
Now I done rambled. Stand up.
We trust that you were blessed by the Word of God and the flow of the Spirit of God in this service. If you would like to contact us, please write us via email at office@fvc.org or using our mailing address, P.O. Box 7752, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27417. If you would like to contribute to our ministry, please go to our website at www.fbc.org and click on the Giving Online button. Thank you, and may God richly bless you for your giving.